What's going on, y'all? It's JD Pakel. Today on the Hard Count, we're going to talk about our picks for the opening weekend of the college football season. Welcome into 365 Sports. We're so glad you're here. Subscribe to the channel. We want you to stay around here and be a part of everything that's going to happen as we jump into the beautiful thing that is college football season. So us here at the Hard Count, we're going to go 5 days a week. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, you're getting a new Hard Count, and we're so excited to keep this party rolling as we jump into it. So speaking of jumping into it, the college football season is officially launch. We got the soft launch last weekend with Illinois and Nebraska getting things teed up. Obviously, Hawaii, UCLA, and some other games, but this is the big shebang. Everyone's playing. Everyone's teeing it up. Everyone's going to go 11-on-11 and play some live football. These games now count. No more spring games. No more camp whispers and intel. No more rumors. No more conference realignment for the most part, we're hoping. But this is going to be everything that we have hoped and dreamed as college football fans since the whole COVID scare a year ago. This is the best part of what we do. This is the best part of the college football calendar year is the actual game. So let's get right into it. We got some picks. No shortage of ranked matchups, no shortage of exciting matchups. Obviously, the biggest one, the one that College Game Day will be at, Clemson and Georgia. Number 5 ranked Georgia, number 3 ranked Clemson in Charlotte. So a neutral site. I expect both these fan bases to travel pretty well. I mean, Clemson's right there, Georgia's right there. Both these fan bases are absolutely nuts, which we love it. Nuts in the absolute best sense of the word. But this is basically going to be a playoff atmosphere, especially for Clemson. Georgia, I think, has a chance to make it up on their resume the rest of the year, given they'll have to run the gauntlet in a lot of ways for the SEC, especially if they make that title game and end up playing what you would assume would be Alabama. But for Clemson, past this game, things get a lot easier until their conference championship game. So this is a big hurdle for both programs. I think it means a ton for Clemson. Really corks the bat for them as they move forward. I think if they won this game, it would get them a mulligan potentially, depending on what they do the rest of the schedule and depending on who they were to lose to if it comes to that. But enough talking. Let's get into it. Clemson's going to rotate centers, according to Dabo Swinney, in this game, which, if you're a Clemson fan, makes you feel a little bit uneasy going against the stout defensive line of Georgia. Georgia playing without Darnell Washington, their stud tight end, who's about 6'7 and 200, and I want to say like 60 pounds. Dude's absolutely a freak. And then Tyke Smith, the transfer from West Virginia, he is not playing in this game. We are assuming, again, yet to see if that's the official report, but we would assume, based on the timeline we got, they're not going to be playing in this game. So a tough route for Georgia. JT Daniels is really going to be the deciding factor for me in this game. Has he taken that next step from being the guy who comes in the middle of the season to now it being his team? Has he taken over? Has he taken the next step? He's taken over the offense. Because if he's done that, Georgia's going to be really dangerous. They have no shortage of weapons, even without Washington. They got Eric Gilbert, who transferred from LSU, is going to be an absolute presence. He was a tight end for LSU, listed as a wide receiver right now at Georgia. Then the run game will be there for Georgia as well. For Clemson, an embarrassment of riches. DJ Uiagalelei, in my opinion, is going to be the best player in college football when it's all said and done for the 2021 season. About 6'5", maybe I'm even shorting him a little bit there. He's a unit. He can run the football, and he can run the football behind his pads. Has a rocket arm, big-time receiving core. Justin Ross will be back. A lot of length in this receiving group as well. Will Shipley, the freshman, he's going to make his debut against Georgia. So there's so many pieces for Clemson on offense. And then I feel like I've said this in multiple videos, but the entire defense, all 11 starters from a year ago, are back for Clemson in this 2021 season. So a lot to be excited about for both programs. What it comes down to for me is which offense can find their rhythm first and find their rhythm the longest. Because I would expect for both these quarterbacks, I mean, it's their first time starting an opener for either program. I mean, JT Daniels obviously started quite a few games, started some really big games a year ago for the Bulldogs, but this is his first time starting game one for Georgia. And then DJ Uiagalelei, feel like he's been the man since he stepped foot on campus at Clemson. First time getting thrown the keys and saying, all right, it's your team, it's your season, really. Go ahead and do what you do, big fella. So for me, I just think DJ Uiagalelei, the physical tools he has, the weapons Clemson has, the question marks that I still have about JT Daniels and this offense as a whole make me side with Clemson. And then also just the defense. The fact that you have everybody coming back on defense, it takes a minute to gel, honestly. That first game, there are still some jitters. There are still some things that you're trying to work out kinks-wise. So for that reason, I like Clemson to win this game. Clemson's favored by, I think it is 3 or 3.5 at the time of this recording. I'm not going to go ahead and make a play on that. But bottom line, I like Clemson. I think it's close. I think that's within a score, whether it's 7 or 3. Then you got number 16. LSU coming to the Rose Bowl, making a trip out to the best coast to play UCLA. UCLA took Hawaii to the woodshed last week. If you saw that game, Dorian Thompson-Robinson just absolutely went off. Granted, it was against Hawaii. It was not a Power 5 team, and Hawaii had to make the trip from the island to the mainland. Always messes with your travel schedule, but bottom line, UCLA is really good. Like, UCLA looked really polished. Kirk Herbstreit came on game day and said he thinks UCLA could be a sleeper team. He thinks this is Chip Kelly's year to finally figure it out and get his program going at UCLA. Now, for LSU, in the same way, they're trying to get back on track. Obviously, you had the national championship season in 2019. In 2020, just looked nothing at all like that team that won the title the year before. A lot of things that are changing for them, notably quarterback Max Johnson is going to be the guy by default. Miles Brennan was injured in camp, and obviously, you know, by default, like I said, handed the job to Max Johnson. Max Johnson got a chance to play quite a bit a season ago. This is the first time for it to be actually his team. So a lot of question marks around him. But the defense is what we've heard a lot about for LSU. Elias Ricks, most notably one of the lockdown corners for LSU. I think the speed of LSU is going to test Dorian Thompson-Robinson. The key to this game for me is, can Dorian Thompson-Robinson create plays when it all breaks down? When that big defensive line of LSU gets after you, can you make a man miss? Can you create a play? Can you create a positive play when things don't go as right, when they're off schedule? So I don't have enough faith in DTR just yet. I think he's a phenomenal player. I like him a whole lot the rest of the way. I think LSU is going to be a whole different kind of tempo than Hawaii. So for that reason, I like LSU. LSU -3 feels safe to me. I would take that. Again, if I was a gambling man, I'm not this weekend. But all that's to say, LSU gets it done on the road at the Rose Bowl against UCLA. Then you got number 23, Louisiana, going to Austin, going to the Sark Tank to play University of Texas. UT -9.5. That's a lot for a first-year head coach, a first-year starting quarterback, and for a team in Louisiana that beat Iowa State a year ago in their opener. So, bottom line, let's just say this. If Louisiana wins this game, this is not an upset. Okay? I don't care how mad you are. This is not an upset. Louisiana is the 23rd-ranked team. Texas is the 21st-ranked team. Two spots does not make it an upset. I don't care what your logo is. I don't care how much money your athletic department has. If Louisiana wins this game, it's because they're the better team. Louisiana's going to run the football. They were 5.5 yards a clip a year ago, number 11 in the country. Texas, named a starting quarterback, sort of, kind of. Hudson Carr is going to be the guy who takes the first team snaps, who takes, you know, the first series, I should say. Casey Thompson's going to play. Steve Sarkisian's came out and said that. For me, I am wondering how much are you able to let Hudson Card run your offense? And how comfortable does Hudson Card feel being the guy? Because if I'm Hudson Card, I'm looking over my shoulder every few snaps and saying, okay, are they going to pull me? Was that good enough for Sark? Are they happy with me? Am I doing enough to keep this job? So for me, can Texas find a quarterback in this game? Because if they can't, you got a whole lot of trouble the rest of your schedule. And for Louisiana, can you dictate your tempo? Can you stop the run first and foremost? Can you stop Bijan Robinson, which is a tall order, and then can you play your game and stay out ahead of Texas? Because if it turns into a shootout, I don't really like Louisiana quite as much. Bottom line, the keys to the game, can Texas stop the run? I think they can, even more so. I think Bijan Robinson's going to get going. I think he's going to have a big day. He's going to have a coming out party. I think he has the best odds in Vegas to win the Heisman for a non-quarterback player. So bottom line, the talent of Texas is too much for Louisiana. I think Texas has heard trap game all offseason long. It's not going to be a trap game for them. They're going to be ready to roll. Huge pressure, huge expectations. They are able to meet those in the first game against Louisiana. I like UT to get it done. Then we got Alabama-Miami in Atlanta. Yo, the spread is Bama -20. 3 touchdowns. And the crazy thing is, I think they cover it. A new quarterback, obviously, with Bryce Young coming from Southern California, modern-day high school. They just churn out quarterbacks over there, quarterback high. He's had NIL money coming in. How does that affect his play? I don't think it'll affect his play that much. If you give Nick Saban more than a week to prepare for you, you're in trouble. So Miami has a ton of talent. Derek King is one of my favorite players in all of college football, another guy who's got quite a bit of an NIL bag. I hope he's healthy. We're going to look at that in the early going. Is he able to be the Derek King before the knee injury? I hope so. I sincerely hope so, because he's a special player. But bottom line, Alabama's green at a lot of places, but they're going to be ready to roll. Like, a Nick Saban coach program, a Nick Saban recruited program even more so, is going to be ready to roll. I expect Bryce Young to look like a seasoned veteran out there, and for Alabama to cover that 20, honestly. I know that's a little bit disrespectful. Call me crazy, but I don't think that De'Eriq King making his return against a team like Alabama is at all the situation you want to find yourself in if you're at the Roost. So I'm rolling with the Tide, and that's that. Lastly, Penn State at Wisconsin. Wisconsin minus -5. What does Wisconsin look like on offense? Graham Mertz started off really hot a year ago. COVID kind of bit this team in the behind. Weren't able to ever really get into a rhythm after his dynamic debut. We could see Wisconsin be that team that's scored a lot of points. We're used to seeing them be that team that kind of goes ground and pound, run the clock, 4 or 5 yards of cloud of dust, 3 or 4 tight ends. Not to say it still won't have 3 or 4 tight ends in the game, but I think we might see them air it out a little bit. They got a talented quarterback with Graham Mertz for Penn State. I like Sean Clifford. I hope he has a good season. I hope that Penn State can get their mojo back the rest of the way, but I don't think it's going to be against Wisconsin, especially at Wisconsin. So I like Wisconsin. I like them with the 5. I just think there's too much that we know about Wisconsin. I think they're too stable, if that's a word I can use. I think they have too much built out around Graham Mertz to where I feel comfortable with them rolling with that minus -5. So those are the games I'm watching. Just so excited it's back, y'all. So excited college football is back and that we get to be a part of it. A little bit of housekeeping before we leave. Tell us what you want to see, because like I said, this is a community. We go back and forth with y'all about what we think in opinions and comment sections and all that. Comment below what kind of content you want to see, because that's the kind of content we're going to produce. That's the kind of business we're in here at The Hard Count, for the people, by the people, with the people. We want to keep that kind of thing going. We're going to keep this party rolling as we jump into the beautiful thing that is college football on opening weekend. Enjoy opening weekend, and we will see y'all next time.